Hello, it's my solo ep. That's me, Yvie Jones. That's my voice. You're listening to it. Thank you for letting me speak to you. Recording on Wurundjeri land, and it's a beautiful day. You know, I record this obviously before Tuesdays. It's going to be like a million degrees all weekend in Melbourne, and the aircon's going to be getting a workout. That's all I've got to say. Got my foster dog, Rex, who's just been adopted. Stop it. The most adorable retired couple came up from Port Arlington, which is about an hour and a half drive to Melbourne, to meet him yesterday. And it was such a beautiful meet and greet. And you know what? As they were leaving, Jen said to me, "And thank you for what you do, Yvie." And I was just like, oh, that's so, I really appreciate you saying that. You're welcome, and thank you for saying that. Because they remind me of my mum and dad, like when they lost their last dog, Jen and Gary, said they weren't going to do this again because it's so heartbreaking when you lose a dog. And I said, oh, my mum did the same. And then they ended up adopting. And Jen and Gary, you know, 2 years down the track have gone, the house is not the same. And they're adopting a senior. They only adopt seniors. So, you know, beautiful people. But I did get a DM from someone saying, can you talk about the foster process? Like, what is that like? Like, how do you get into it? What do you do when you're in it? And how do you deal? I have said to you before, giving up, I could never let them go. How do you do it? You know, and I always say, sometimes it's really easy. But other times it's not, and those ones stick in your heart for a while. But keeping them and finding them a new home and seeing that connection happen and then receiving these beautiful photos and videos and updates, or pupdates as we like to call them, happen makes it all worth it. Like, makes that pain go away and worth the pain. You know, I am a big one for pain is part of life. So you want to know what you can and can't deal with as far as pain goes. With fostering, as in the same as a lot of things, like fostering humans or working in, you know, human services, you do need to take breaks. You need to know when your burnout is about to happen or you're getting close to it. And that's a really great thing. So let's go back to the beginning, because that's something that I do want to touch on. With fostering, it's a volunteer position. You don't get paid. You don't get reimbursed for petrol. That's one thing. In Victoria, you don't. We have looked into that, and no, you don't, which is really annoying. And you can't write it off on tax for some reason, your petrol, your Ks. And I think that that needs to change, but that's another kettle of fish. Find yourself a rescue that you like. Find yourself a rescue that's close to you as well and offer your services. They do like to have foster people. Foster people can be very different to the adopter because you've got all sorts of different types of dogs or cats coming through your house. So they do like you to have a backyard. I have a backyard, but it's not a very good one. Like, there's no grass or anything. Whereas adopting a dog out, you want to have someone with a grass in their backyard. Like, I, you know, have to choose that. I actually am an urban liver, and the suburban livers are the majority of my dog rescue, and they don't understand and will not believe me when I try to tell them about the difference between owning a dog in urban living and owning a dog in suburban living. I have done both and I've seen both, and a dog being owned by someone in an apartment will get walked way more than a dog that lives in a house in the suburbs, because they have a backyard and they go, look at the backyard. They've got all this space. Dogs don't want a big backyard for space. They don't care. They want you. They're pack animals and they want to stay with you. Have you ever noticed they just sit at the back door waiting for you to let them back in? That's why. Whereas urban dogs, they go to the park at least three times a day. Because you've got a small balcony. So that's your nighttime toilet, and you need to run them out because you live in a freaking apartment. A lot of them don't let them adopt, which I really, really have a problem with. But I don't run these joints, so I'm just trying to make some little differences. So you find yourself one that's close by, because you will also need to get them to your close by vet of their choice. And that's another thing that for me, I am quite far away from my rescue. I'm the only one that lives on the east side. Everyone is in the west, and so are the vets. So it's a big hike for me. So that's a big point tip that I give advice to anyone that's thinking. So you have to do a application, and then they have to come and see your house and make sure that it has really great fences, and there's nowhere for a dog to escape, and there's enough room for a dog to live, and that you're a pretty good person. Singles, couples, families, elderly, whatever, anyone can be a foster carer. Full-time workers is not often great, because you're a lot of the time getting dogs that are coming with a bit of trauma, or just transitional trauma. Like they've come from a house that they were not happy in or very happy in, and all of a sudden they're in a complete stranger's home and you're leaving to go to work 8 hours a day. That doesn't work. So it often works well with mums. I have found that the majority of foster carers are women, and women who work part-time, casual, or work from home, or are stay-at-home mums. So that seems to work really great. You need to be able to have enough time to get them to vets if something goes wrong. A lot of the time they need a D6 or a vaccination or a microchip insertion. So you have to be really ready to do those kind of things. The rest of it, they come with stuff. That's another reason why you want to be close to the rescue, because if you run out of food, you need to go and get some more food. We get donated food. What works with our dog rescue, and I'm not sure about others, but it has worked with other places that I've fostered through. For adoptions, the applications that go through to the rescue, they get forwarded straight on to the carers, because you're the one with the dog and you know their temperament best. So you get to go through all of the applications and decide who gets the meet and greets, and then ultimately who is the one that's getting the dog, which is great, because, you know, that's a big process and that can be really difficult, but it can also be really fun to choose, and a little bit of a power trip, you know, I'm God, I'm choosing here. But, you know, and some dogs get so many applications and others get no applications. It breaks your heart. So we also help each other out. The best thing about fostering in a group for a dog rescue organization is the support that you get. So when you need help, others are there to help you out. Like if you need to go on a holiday, or you're going away, or you're just like, this dog is not suited for me, or my house is not suited for this dog, they'll either do a swap with you or they'll just take the dog for you. I am best with seniors, and so is my house. So when it comes to fostering and adoption, you are saving the life of the dog that you've just adopted or fostered, plus you're making room for the rescue or the pound to bring in another dog. So there's your two lives right there. What better reasons are there? On that note, have a lovely week. We have a wonderful ep coming up on Thursday. I'm not going to tell you who it is, because you can just wait and see, but I know you'll love her. I love you. And on that note, goodbye.